So we know that cyclohexane exists in a chair conformation, but it turns out that there are two chair conformations that exist for every cyclohexane ring. So shown here is one example of a cyclohexane. Notice that I've highlighted all of the axial positions with yellow bonds, and the equatorial are white. And this is one possible chair conformation for cyclohexane, but it can undergo a chair flip to give another possible conformation. That's where all the yellow bonds have now moved to the equatorial positions, and the white ones are in the axial positions. And what's happened here is we've taken this carbon and rotated it down, flipped it down. We've taken this carbon and flipped it up. And so we've converted from one chair where we go zigzag, up, down, up, to another chair where we go down, up, down. And we'll notice that when we do a chair flip, all of the groups that were previously in equatorial positions will now be in axial, and everything that was axial is now equatorial. So for example, if we take a look at methyl cyclohexane, we've done one chair conformation here, and now to draw the other chair conformation, we take this carbon and flip it down. The zigzag up was down. This carbon, we flip it up. And so the new chair conformation that we have is going to be kind of a mirror image of the original chair conformation. And this carbon on the far right had the methyl. Let's draw on the other position. We know we have an axial hydrogen here as well. So that carbon is still on the far right. Here are the two positions. And the methyl was in the up position originally. It's still going to be in the up position, but now the up position is in the axial position. So the two chair conformations of methyl cyclohexane have one with the methyl in the equatorial position, that's our first structure here, and one where the methyl is in an axial position. Now another question we can ask is which of these two conformations is more stable? And it turns out that the equatorial is more stable. And that's because when it's in the axial position, that larger group can have steric interaction, steric strain, with the other axial positions. These are called 1,3 diaxial interactions. And it's an example of steric strain. And so when you have large groups, those are going to interact with those with not prefer to be in the axial position. So let's try an example, another example. It says draw both chair conformations of cis 1-tert-butyl-4-methyl cyclohexane and then compare the two and determine which is the more stable conformation. So first of all, we have to think about the word cis. The word cis means that the two groups are on the same side. So that means they are either both up or they're both down. So it's your choice on whether you want to put them in the up or down position. We can also decide where we want our carbons to be. Let's say this is carbon 1, 2, 3, 4. So on carbon 1, here are two positions. On carbon 4, here are two positions. So we want to put a tert butyl on carbon 1. It's our choice whether we want to put it up or down. Let's put it in the up position like this, and a hydrogen here. But if the tert butyl goes up, that means the methyl on carbon 4 also has to be in the up position. So this is one chair conformation. Now to do the other chair conformation, we take the carbon on the far left and flip it up. The carbon on the far right was up, so we flip it down. And now here's the important part, is we number our carbons. We have to make sure we keep track of the same carbons and keep the proper orientation. So this carbon on the far left is still the carbon on the far left. And then remember, the way that we look at a chair conformation is these front carbons, these lower carbons, are the ones that are pointing out towards us. So they're still over here. So this is carbon 2, this is carbon 3, this is carbon 4. And so our two groups now are going to be still on carbon 1 and carbon 4, and they started out both up. We decided to make them both up, so they're still going to be both up. That puts the tert butyl here and the hydrogen, And in carbon 4, we have the methyl here and the hydrogen. So those are our two chair conformations. And now we can ask which one is more stable. We know we want our larger groups to be in the equatorial position, but in this case, we can't have them both equatorial. In the first structure, we have our T-butyl group gets to be equatorial, but the methyl is axial. In the second structure, the tert-butyl is axial, and the methyl is equatorial. So knowing that it has to do with steric strain and steric crowding, what we want to do is we want to look at our largest group, and we want that to be in the equatorial position. So of course, the tert-butyl group is the really big group, and that's the one, if you tried to put that in the axial position, it does major crashing with these other axials. So there's what we could say is, so we can determine that this first structure is more stable, and the second structure is less stable, and that's because the large tert-butyl group prefers the equatorial position. We describe the tert-butyl group because it's so big, as having large axial strain, and so this is a larger axial strain or an A value than the methyl group. So our equilibrium really lies in the reverse direction here. In fact, in equilibrium, there's something like 99.9% of the these compounds, this molecule, is going to exist in this first structure, in this first conformation, because that's significantly more stable.